Now on Radio 4, our Saturday play takes us to 1940s Paris. Using the novel that inspired Alfred Hitchcock's film Vertigo, we present the first ever dramatization for radio.
The Living and the Dead by Pierre Boileau and Thomas Narcejac. Dramatized by Adrian Bean.
Tom. Look.
Down.
Oh, it's people below. Tiny people like ants. Oh. Don't look down.
No, look.
Down. Oh, God, I can't stop myself. I'm leaning over now. Nothing holding me.
No, look.
Oh, God. Please. No.
And the nightmares are always the same.
Yes. I'm on the roof.
Is it a particular roof?
What?
Is it the roof, perhaps, where...
Yes. It's where... He died.
And you blame yourself for his death?
Well, yeah, of course, it was my fault. If I'd gone instead of him, then...
You might be dead. Fear of heights is a perfectly rational phenomenon.
That doesn't make it any easier to live with.
Of course. Monsieur Flavier, I am sure we can control your fear, perhaps even cure you of it. But you must tell me everything first.
Everything?
You uttered a woman's name. At the point when you thought you hit the ground, you uttered Madeleine. Who is Madeleine?
Oh, She was a woman I knew a long time ago.
Here, in Paris?
Yes, before the war.
And Madeleine meant something to you. Does she still?
I think about her all the time.
Perhaps you want to see her again?
Yes, I do.
Why don't you tell me about her?
It started in 1940. The spring, April. I'd spent the morning queuing outside the enlistment center in Paris.
This was before the Germans invaded.
The phony war, yes.
Next!
The waiting, the not knowing was agony. Would they actually attack? Would Paris be bombed? So I thought I'd better try and do my bit. Unfortunately, the army doctor didn't see it that way. Passed me.
Unfit for service.
What?
You've got a weak chest. But don't worry, I'm sure we'll beat the Germans without you. Next!
I hid in the cinema. My favourite boat hole when I needed to escape.
While the citizens of Paris are enjoying the first days of spring, further north the dark clouds of war are gathering. On the German border, France's mighty armies stand proud and defiant against the threats from Hitler's Wehrmacht. In the air, our gallant French pilots scan the horizon for the first sign of Nazi aggression, prepared to return the force with force. And in every town and village, France's brave young men are coming forward to enlist for military service in this their country's greatest hour of need.
That was enough. I went back to my apartment where I had my office.
Flavier! It's you, isn't it?
Yes, but,
Juvigny. Paul Juvigny. You remember?
Of course. Juvigny. Oh, but, it must be...
15 years. At least. You look good. I know. I've put on weight. And my factory at La Havre has been working non-stop since the mobilisation.
Which is why you're not in uniform.
That's right. Cheers.
Cheers. So, what can I do for you?
Well, this isn't easy.
I want you to do a bit of detective work. Keep your eye on somebody for me.
Well, no, it's a long time since I did anything like that.
I'd make it worth your while.
I don't know.
It's my wife.
You're joking. Oh, I see. Look, Paul, I'm not a detective anymore. You know, I'm a lawyer.
I know, but you're the only one who can help me. I don't know where else to turn.
Spying on your wife?
Like I say, this isn't easy. Madeline and I have been married for 4 years. We're very happy. We've got everything we want.
Our children?
Not yet, but...
Well, okay, go on.
We're very happy. And yet there's something wrong. Ever since I knew her, she's been a bit, well, you know, up one minute, down the next.
Unstable?
I wouldn't put it quite like that, but I'm not a doctor or a lawyer. Anyway, over the last few months, she's become a lot worse. At first, I put it down to the war, the anxiety, you know. We'll be talking, and she'll suddenly go quiet. I can't snap her out of it. Or she'll stare at something for minutes on end, off in her own world. And then she's back again. But she'll have this strange expression on her face, as if she doesn't even recognize me. It's scary, you know.
What does the doctor say?
We've seen the best doctors in Paris. They can't find anything wrong with her.
Physically, but psychologically?
The psychiatrists say the same. Nothing wrong.
A cigarette.
Thanks. The other day, I followed her into the Bois de Boulogne. She sat by the lake for over an hour, never moved, just stared at the water as if it meant something to her, like she was searching for something in there.
And she had no idea that you were watching?
None at all. But when I asked her about it, she said she'd never even been out of the house. And you know what? She was so convincing, even I started to think I'd imagined it.
She go to church?
Yes, but I wouldn't say she was, you know...
Interested in fortune-telling, psychic stuff?
No, not Madeline.
Does she sleepwalk?
Not that I know of, when she was a child, perhaps. But this isn't like being asleep. She's, what's the word? Absent. As if she was somewhere else. No, that's not it. It's as if for a few minutes she's become someone else. What do you make of that?
Well, I know you don't want to hear this, but if there's nothing wrong with her, mentally or physically, then it sounds like she's putting on an act, and that usually means there's a man involved.
You honestly think that hasn't occurred to me? Night after night, I've thought of nothing else. But I know Madeline loves me.
Without something more concrete to go on, I'm not sure what I can...
There is one thing. Madeline's great-grandmother was a woman called Pauline Joubert. Bit odd, by all accounts. When she was young, she was quite ill. They had to lock her in her room because she used to have these convulsions.
Fits.
Well, I don't know exactly. It seems she had her heart set on being a nun. But they wouldn't let her. Maybe that was it. Anyway, she got married, had a baby. She became a very accomplished painter. And then, out of the blue, she committed suicide. She was 25. That's Madeline's age now.
Yeah. And Madeline knows about this Pauline Joubert?
No, she doesn't. I got the story from Madeline's mother soon after we were married. Why do they always wait until after you're married to rattle the family skeletons? Yeah. Anyway, she made me swear never to breathe a word about it to Madeline. Mm.
I still don't see what this has to do with her.
You will. Madeline inherited a lot of her great-grandmother's jewellery when her mother died, including this necklace.
Mm. Valuable?
No, it's just amber. But it seems to have some special meaning for Madeline. She's always taking it out and gazing at it, as if it reminds her of something. And we've a painting of Pauline Joubert in the house. It's a self-portrait of her wearing this necklace. And Madeline spends hours staring at it. Once,
I even found her with the picture propped up beside a mirror, and she had the necklace on and was doing her hair just like in the portrait. And she's worn it like that ever since. A heavy bun on the neck, very old-fashioned, you know. Don't you see, Flavia? She thinks she's someone else.
Someone who committed suicide.
Look, I could do with some air.
There's a cafe on the corner. Let's walk.
Sous le ciel clair de Sorrente, un beau jour, tu m'as paru si jolie.
So, how did you meet her? Madeleine.
It was quite romantic, actually. We met in Rome. I was there on business. We were staying at the same hotel.
What was she doing in Rome?
Studying painting. She has a real talent, just like Pauline.
Yes, monsieur.
I have two cognacs, please. Just one question.
Yes?
Why me?
You're one of my oldest friends. And I couldn't go to the police with a crazy story like this. So when I heard that you'd left...
Yes, I left the police. You know why?
No, but...
I had to leave.
Monsieur?
Thank you.
I joined up after we left university. I didn't want to. It was my father's idea.
He was high up in the force, wasn't he?
Yeah. Wanted me to follow in his footsteps. Didn't care what I wanted. Anyway, I worked my way up, became a detective. Actually, I did quite well. One night, though, I was after this man. Nothing special. He wasn't dangerous, just a thief. But he knew that we were after him. And we tracked him down to an apartment on the other side of the city. I tried to arrest him, but he took it into his head to climb out onto the roof. So we followed him. It's me and Lariche, young lad, as decent a cop as you could hope to find. Married, with kids. We climbed out onto a ledge, and I could see the guy just a few feet away, hiding behind a chimney. It was high up. Very high, about 100 feet up.
You're right, sir.
I can't move.
It's gonna get away!
I can't move. I can't. Go.
It's all right, sir. I'll get him. Just wait there, you bastard! Come on!
Lloris!
I'm going up! I'm all right! I'm all right! No! No!
They had to get me down. Fire brigade, ladders. I was a wreck. After the funeral, I couldn't face it anymore.
I'm sorry. But you can't blame yourself.
No.
Anyone's nerve can give way.
I know it can. I'm just not the man for the job.
Hey, it'll be easy.
I can't help you.
Just keep an eye on Madeleine. I'm frightened. She may come to some harm. Tell me what she does, where she goes, who she sees. Look after her.
That's all?
That's all.
Okay.
Good. As soon as you've anything to tell me, give me a ring at the office. Here's my card. Or better still, come and see me. Are you free tonight?
No.
Oh, pity. I'd have asked you over for dinner. Then you could meet her.
No, bad idea. Better she doesn't know me. Go to the theatre together. That way I can have a good look without her noticing.
Brilliant. We'll be at the Marigny tomorrow. We've got a box.
That evening I felt uneasy. I couldn't settle. I didn't like Gervinia. He was so smug and self-assured. And yet Madeleine... I was intrigued. Who was this woman who thought she was someone else? And why did she need protection? And from what? Before the house lights went down, I scanned the boxes with my opera glasses. There were uniforms everywhere. And the women with the officers looked so proud and self-satisfied. I hated the army. And the war. I hated the whole thing. Then I saw Gervinia sitting up there like an ugly fat toad. Madeleine was masked by the drapes. and then she leaned forward. Her diamond suddenly sparkling in the light, perfectly poised. Framed in the pale gilt of the box, I could see her fine cheekbones, her luminous blue eyes and her delicate lips. All that was missing was the artist's signature in the corner. J.F. Javinia leant over to kiss her, but she seemed distant, like a stranger to him. Well, I'd seen that look before. The adulteress. I couldn't blame her if she was having an affair. A woman like that was wasted on Javinia. I left at the interval, unable to take any more. The over-decorative theatre, the atmosphere so martial and frivolous. Now, the actors make the kissing and the lovemaking all look so real, but it's false. A lie. They're all just like me, really, you know, clinging onto a ledge, teetering above an abyss of the unknown. But try as I might, I couldn't get Madeleine's beautiful face out of my head. The next morning, I sat outside the little restaurant opposite their apartment for hours. No sign of her.
Coffee? Anything to eat, monsieur?
No, thanks.
Why should she come out at all? Was this whole thing just a waste of time? No. She come all right. Because of the sunshine, because of the tender green leaves and the balmy spring air. And she come because I was waiting for her. And then suddenly there she was. She was wearing a grey suit, very tight at the waist. She looked around as she finished putting on her gloves. Some delicate white lace fluttered at her throat.
Hello?
Hello, Jack. You got anything for me?
She's remarkably beautiful.
Yes. Where did she go?
She walked to the Trocadero.
Did she meet anyone?
No, she just seemed to be wandering. I followed her for a couple of hours. We ended up in the cemetery at Passy. She spent a long time just looking at a tomb. It was...
Pauline Roubert's?
Yes.
What did I tell you? She's obsessed with a woman. How did she seem?
Oh, she seemed... She seemed distant, as if she was thinking deeply about something.
What else?
Nothing, really. She went back to the river and stood on the bridge for an hour or so.
Could it have been a rendezvous?
No, she didn't talk to a soul.
But whoever she was meeting could have spotted you.
No, excuse me. I know how to follow someone, Javinia. She wasn't meeting anyone. Oh, no, there was one thing, though.
Yes?
When she was in the cemetery, she picked up a flower. A red tulip from one of the graves. She still had it when she stood on the bridge. She dropped it into the river and watched as the waters took it away.
Strange. You'll watch her again tomorrow?
Yes. Javinia. Pauline Joubert. Did she live in Paris?
I think so. Yes. An old house on the Rue des Saint-Pères, I think. There was a large laburnum in the front garden. I don't know if the place is still there.
Coffee, please.
Right. Monsieur is waiting for someone.
No.
Javinia left the apartment first, driving off in the big black Talbot. Madeleine appeared soon after, wearing the same grey suit. She set off immediately, walking quickly.
Here. You keep the change.
Oh, thank you, monsieur.
I followed as close as I could, close enough to reach out and touch. Every now and then catching a waft of her perfume. A strange, complex smell. And it reminded me of freshly dug earth and dead flowers. Oh, no, of course it was the cemetery. She'd worn the same perfume the day before. After about half an hour, we came to the Rue des Saint-Pères, and she went into a large, rather run-down hotel with an old laburnum in the front garden. Pauline Joubert's old house. I waited for a few minutes, then...
Oh, single rooms, 4 francs a night. 2 francs extra for a bath.
No, I don't want a room. I want to know the name of the woman who just came in.
And who are you?
In my wallet, I still have my old police identity card. I knew it would come in useful sometime.
Police.
Detective Inspector Flavier. Oh, well. The lady's name is Madeleine Javigna.
Well, does she come here often?
Every week.
Does she ever have a visitor in her room?
Of course not. She's a respectable lady.
So what does she do here?
Oh, I don't know. I'm not a spy.
Which room?
Number 19 on the third floor. I offered her room number 12, which has a much nicer view. But she wouldn't listen. It had to be that room or nothing.
Why?
Well, she didn't say and I didn't ask.
Okay.
Taxi?
Madeleine. In the street already? Where had she come from?
Taxi!
Taxi! Hey! Taxi!
Follow that Renault. Over there.
She'd almost given me the slip. She was heading to the Etoile. There were uniforms everywhere and big cars flying pennants. The traffic was as thick as any day before the war.
Don't lose her.
Why did Madeleine insist on that particular room? Unless it had been Pauline Joubert 70 years before. But how would she know that that was Pauline's room? And why would she go there?
All right, drop me here, will you?
She'd brought me down to the docks, to Courbevoie, a rough area, not the kind of place you'd go for a walk. I had to hang back. Madeleine walked slowly, never looking behind, that same preoccupied expression on her beautiful face. What was troubling her? A soft breeze was blowing, just strong enough to make her skirt flutter as she stopped at the edge of the quay. Calmly, she looked down into the water. Was she looking at her reflection, broken into a thousand shimmering pieces by the wake of a steamer? Or was she thinking about Pauline Joubert? Then, as if in a dream, she stepped forward.
Madeleine! Madeleine! Oh, my God!
I'm sorry, Madeleine. Oh, you're so beautiful.
So they're right. It doesn't hurt to die.
No. You're not dead.
But who?
Come on. Let's get you out and dry.
Hello?
My God. We've had an accident. What happened? If you can get her into some dry clothes, I'll get a taxi. No. I left my wallet and my jacket on the quayside. I'll go and get it. Give her a drink. I'm making a strong one.
I ran to the quayside, exhilarated like a new man. I'd saved Madeleine. I'd held her in my arms and brought her back from certain death. But I couldn't forget the sight of her calmly stepping over the brink and falling, abandoning herself to the river without a struggle. I will never let her out of my sight again. She needed protection against herself.
Where is she? In the back room, changing.
All right. Oh, can I use the phone?
Sure. You could do with some dry clothes too. I'll find something upstairs.
Thank you.
Ah, hello, yes, I need a taxi, quickly. Quai de Courbois, the Bistro Bleu. Yes, as soon as you can. Yes.
Monsieur.
Mademoiselle.
You're soaking. You must go and change.
Oh, he's finding me some clothes.
This dress is all they had. It's far too big for me. What must I look like?
Like you've just been pulled from the river?
Next time I'll be more careful.
I hope there won't be a next time. Where can I take you?
Just go to your place first. Don't worry about me.
You drop us at the corner of the Rue Lamartine.
This is very embarrassing.
No. Thank you, monsieur, for saving me. Hardly a thought for the man who'd risked his life for her.
You're angry with me. I don't know what happened.
You tried to kill yourself.
It's not what you think.
How do you know what I think?
It doesn't matter.
Well, of course it matters. Why would a beautiful woman want to throw herself in the river? Unless you're carrying around some terrible sorrow.
You wouldn't understand.
No, maybe I would, if you told me.
I wanted to throw myself into the water. But I honestly don't know why. Do you think it's possible for the dead to live again, monsieur? I mean, can someone die and then come back and live in another person's body?
You mean reincarnation?
Yes, that's it. What do you think?
Well,
you think I'm mad?
No, I didn't say that.
I'm not mad. But I have these memories. From way back, before I was born even, I know that I lived another life before this one. I don't know why I'm telling you all this.
But what has that got to do with this afternoon and the river?
I don't know. I honestly don't know. It's as if my real life lies behind me way back in the past, and so there's no point in going on with this one, do you see?
No, you mustn't talk like that. Think of your husband.
Oh, my God. Paul, if he knew...
No, don't tell him. Let it be our secret.
If you think so.
Well, here we are. Excuse the mess, I'm not...
Too busy to pick things up.
Yes, yes. Let me get that. Please, take a seat. Hello. Hello, Jacques Flavière.
It's me, Javine.
Oh. Hello.
Where have you been? I've been ringing you all afternoon.
Yes, I was out.
I suddenly remembered something I didn't tell you before. About Pauline Joubert's suicide.
Yes?
She drowned herself.
I see.
Threw herself into the river in broad daylight. They couldn't save her. I don't know whether it's any use, but I thought you should know.
Yeah. Thanks.
And what about you? Any news for me?
I'll tell you tomorrow. I better go now. I'm with a client. Okay? So, bye-bye. All right.
Yes.
I almost had to pinch myself. Here she was, Madeleine, standing in my apartment, in that cheap print dress at my window with the sun shining through her damp hair.
Are you warm enough?
I'm fine.
Let me get you a drink.
No. I'd better go.
No, please stay.
No.
Madeleine. Can I see you again?
Yes.
Les assassinats taisés cherchent pour s'agriter.
My diary was full. April the 27th, walked in the Bois de Boulogne. 28th, Paramount Cinema, a silly comedy, and we laughed a lot. Afterwards, tea by the Eiffel Tower.
Madame? Monsieur? Oh, cakes. I love cakes. What's so funny?
No, nothing.
I don't care. I'm starving.
Why, you eat so much, and yet you seem to lack substance. Go on, eat up, little Eurydice.
Why do you call me that?
Oh, don't you like it?
Well, it's a nice name, but why?
Well, you know the story.
Remind me.
Well, Eurydice was a beautiful nymph, the wife of Orpheus,
A snake bit her and she died and was taken down to the underworld. But Orpheus couldn't bear to lose her. He loved her so much, so he travelled into the underworld in search of her, and he found her and persuaded the gods to allow him to take her back. But he was given one instruction, that he must not look back at her on the upward journey.
Why?
Because if he did, she would return to the underworld and be lost forever.
And he did?
Of course. He loved her. He couldn't take his eyes off her.
Typical man. You brought me back from the underworld, didn't you?
Yes, I suppose I did.
29th. Drove to Rambouillet in the Chevreuse Valley. She drives well, although with a certain fatalism.
Oh, God, that was close. Didn't you see him?
Sorry.
And she never chooses where to go. I always have to make the decisions.
May I have a light?
April 30th. Marignan. Tea at the Galerie Lafayette.
Jacques?
Oh, sorry, yes.
Could we go up the Eiffel Tower today?
I'd rather not.
I haven't been for years. You get such a wonderful view of Paris from up there.
That's true, but...
So why don't we go?
I just... Please, I'd rather not.
As you wish. Aren't you eating?
No, I don't think so. I feel uneasy.
Why?
I'm the only man here not in uniform.
So?
Well, that waitress. She hates me. Her boyfriend's probably away in the army, defending the country.
Oh, it's not your fault.
No.
Every day now, the talk was of war, the threat of invasion hanging over us. And yet somehow all that meant nothing when I was with Madeleine. I was probably going to make a terrible fool of myself. But I lived for her. She seemed to take up all my energy. I was like a blood donor. No, like a soul donor.
Hello?
Jacques.
Oh, Madeleine. How are you?
Fine. Fine. Can we go somewhere?
Oh, where would you like to go?
To see some art. The Louvre.
You're all in black today.
I love black. It highlights everything else. Colour is important.
Oh, spoken like a true artist. I wish I could paint. I'd paint you.
That would be a very boring picture.
No, no. It would be beautiful. I'd love to see your paintings one day.
They're nothing really, just dreams. Do you dream in colour?
Oh, I don't know. Do I?
I do. Bright, vivid colours.
Oh, no, I dream in grey, like a photograph. Oh,
then you couldn't possibly understand. You're blind. Dreams are so much more beautiful than the stuff they call reality. Imagine a profusion of colours penetrating right into you, filling you up so completely that you become like a chameleon, invisible against your background. It's like an escape.
Yes. I think I understand. Madeleine? Madeleine?
I've been here before. I've walked through these... on the arm of a man. It was long ago, a long time ago. He was like you, huh? Only he had a beard, and his clothes were different.
Oh, déjà vu?
No, I'm not just talking about now. This man...
Oh, Madeleine, you look like you're going to faint. Here, come, sit down. Here.
I'm sorry.
Oh.
It happens all the time. Sometimes I see a little town. I don't know the name, but I walk through the streets as if I'd always lived there. A river runs through the middle of it. And on the right bank, there's a triumphal arch. And if you go up an avenue of huge plane trees, you see an amphitheatre on your left.
Oh, I know that little town. I used to holiday there. It's called Saint on the River Charente.
And behind the amphitheatre, I can see three poplar trees and a field of sheep.
What? Incredible! But, you know, they've cleared the ground around the amphitheatre. You wouldn't see any poplars now.
Well, there used to be some.
What?
And the little fountain, is that still there? Girls used to throw pins into the water and make a wish that they'd find their sweetheart within the year.
The Fountain of Saint-Estelle? Yes.
You see? I must have lived there once upon a time.
Oh, no, yes, when you were a child, perhaps? The brain can absorb impressions.
No. In another life.
Do you think you might ever want to disappear again?
You haven't understood.
No, that's not an answer.
I can't give you an answer.
But I need one.
Why?
Because I couldn't bear to lose you.
Don't say that.
Because I love you.
Please. Jacques.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Let's go outside. Why did you have to say that?
Well, that I love you?
Shh,
no,
please.
But I do. Are you angry?
No.
Oh, thank God. I'm so glad. I'm amazed. Oh, God, I love you, Madeleine. I never thought I'd be able to say that to anyone.
I think I should go home.
Oh.
I'm sorry. I'm tired.
Yeah, of course. Well, let's find a taxi. Madeleine, I've got a present for you.
What is it?
Open it and see. Go on.
A cigarette lighter.
I knew you needed one. Do you like it?
It's beautiful.
See?
To Eurydice. Revived.
Well, like you say, I rescued you from the underworld.
Yes.
Can we see each other tomorrow?
If you want to.
Oh, no, of course I do. We'll go into the country. No, don't say anything. Leave me the memory of this afternoon just as it is. Taxi! Call me in the morning. Oh, Madeleine, you don't know how happy you've made me. And, Madeleine, you can stop dwelling on the past now.
Only a man who has known the dizzying heights of love, even for the first time, can understand the black depths of despair. All the next morning I waited for her telephone call. None came. I knew she'd be at the Etoile, our usual meeting place at 2, and she was never late. But 2 o'clock came and went. 3 o'clock.
Hello, Monsieur Gervinier's office?
I'd like to speak to him, please.
Oh, I'm afraid he's in love today.
Do you have the number of his office there?
Well, he'll be on his way back now. Shall I give him a message in the morning?
No. Thank you.
Oh, God. What did I know about love? A man who'd been afraid to love anybody. It's an idiot. Stupid to ever think I could have Madeleine. Like a thief wishing out to steal what isn't mine. What could never be mine. I was an outcast. A reject. And yet I loved her. I loved Madeleine. And as the sun rose on a new morning and the pendulum of my mood swung again, I felt a renewed hope.
Paris in the early morning shimmered like a mirage. Never had the light been more tender, more sensual. On a morning like this, you wanted to touch the treetops, to drink in the sky, to take the whole magic of the city into your heart.
Come in, Jack. Sit down. War work. Sometimes I think I'd be better off in a uniform, schlepping around in some godforsaken foxhole. You know, I envy you, Jack. I just love to spend my afternoons escorting a beautiful woman around the place. Cigarette?
No, thanks.
Well, what do you have to report?
I'm in love with your wife.
You look serious. Tell me the worst.
I'm obsessed by her. By her eyes, her smile, her perfume. The touch of her breast against my arm. Every night I dream of lying in her arms in her bed.
Flavier?
Nothing. Well, nothing much. The day before yesterday, we went to the Louvre to see art. Yesterday, I didn't see her. I expected her to ring.
Oh, Madeline wasn't well yesterday. She'll be fine tomorrow.
Oh, did she say anything?
She showed me some trinket she'd bought. A lighter, I think. Wasting my money. She seemed all right to me.
Look, this situation, it's not working.
It won't be for much longer. Anyway, you seem to be enjoying yourself.
I do have other business, you know.
Please, Jacques, I appreciate it. It's a weird situation for all of us, but just give it another couple of weeks, yes? Until things calm down here.
Okay.
Good. You'll keep me informed.
All right. Oh, by the way, do you know if Madeleine's ever been to Sainte?
Sainte? Not that I know of.
Maybe when she was a girl.
No, I'm sure she'd have told me. Any reason?
Well, she described the place to me in perfect detail, but not as it is now. 100 years ago.
What are you getting at?
Could Pauline Joubert have lived there?
Oh, look, man, we're living in the 20th century. You're not going to tell me that Pauline and Madeleine... Of course, I know that Madeleine's obsessed by the woman, but there must be some rational explanation for it. That's why I turned to you. I thought that you, with your rock-solid legal mind...
All right, forget it.
No, please. I'm sorry. We mustn't quarrel over this. All that matters is to protect Madeleine. I don't care whether she's ill, mad, inspired, or possessed. So long as we... You... can keep her alive for me. Please.
All right.
Next morning, everything changed.
Following a build-up of German armored units in the Ardennes region, it is reported that troops, tanks, and artillery have crossed the border.
The storm, which had been building up for months, had finally broken. The war would now take charge of things, forcing me to make decisions. I would go away with Madeleine. We would start a new life together.
Hello.
Have you heard? We're at war.
Yes, I know. I've missed you. I was so worried.
I'm sorry. I wasn't well. Oh. I need to see you. Can we meet?
Oh, of course.
The Etoile, 2 o'clock.
Where have you been? It's nearly 20 past.
You look beautiful.
Do you mind if I drive today?
No, of course. You're sad, Madeleine?
Me? No, I'm just the same as usual. Really, I am.
Is it because of the war? Or is it because of me, what I said at the Louvre?
Please, don't. Let's just go for a good long drive. It may be our last.
Why?
Who knows what will happen in Paris now?
And that's how she drove, foot hard down on the gas, staring dead ahead. As if she was desperate to get away from something. Or someone.
That's a strange-looking church. Part Romanesque, part modern. It's not good.
The tower's too tall for the rest.
Shall we have a look inside? He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father.
She was so white, I thought she was ill. And the dead. For what sin was she asking forgiveness? Would she have gone to hell if she succeeded in drowning herself?
The body and the life everlasting. Amen.
Madeleine? What's the matter?
I believe that nothing ends when we think it does. That's what's so terrible. Come on, let's go.
I can't bear to see you like this.
I'll be fine. I just need some fresh air.
No, that's the wrong door, Madeleine. That leads up to the belfry.
I'd like to take a look.
Well, it's getting late. We should be going back.
I won't be a minute.
I was caught. I couldn't very well stay behind. I followed, slowly, gripping the rope which sneaked up into the tower.
Don't go so quickly. Madeleine?
30 steps round and round, always higher. Not daring to look down. God, why do they make these steps so small?
Please, Madeleine. Wait for me.
Look up. Look up. My grip tightens on the rope, but my hands are cold, sweaty, and the rope slips.
I've got to look up. Don't look down. What's she doing up there?
So faint, head swimming, fingers clawing grass, but any tiny dent in the stones. Hold on. Another window. Look out. Oh, the car, now a toy. At least 70 feet below. The women in the field, dots. They've no idea I'm up here of the sheer terror that's gripping me. All it would take is a little moving, a gentle slip, and I'd be falling. It would be over in seconds. No more terror. I could do it if I wanted. Just one step. No, stop it.
Madeleine? Open the door! No, Madeleine. You mustn't... No, don't do it. No, listen to me, Madeleine!
There's a space. Over there. Only a small one, but big enough for a man. I've got to get through and reach her before she... Oh, my God. But it's so high up. One false step, one slip, and... Oh, God, I can't. I can't move. No.
No!
Blood on the gravel. A gaping black handbag, a gold lighter glinting in the sun. I pick it up, but I can't look at her face. I can't. My poor little Eurydice. Madeleine was dead, and I was dead with her. Do I go to the police? No, I've committed no crime. What that? Put a bullet through my head.
It doesn't hurt to die.
Oh, I haven't the guts. I'm a coward, a prisoner of my own past. Not like Madeleine. Oh, she welcomed death. Escaping this life, going back to something. When I got to Paris, it was in the grip of the blackout. The smell of panic and defeat was in the air. People were fleeing with their belongings tied to car roofs. It was good to wander through these shadows. The land of the living was
far away. Here were only the dead, solitary figures haunted by the bright days of long ago, tortured by a remembered happiness. Some stopped for a moment to look down at the dark river, then moved on again, disappearing into the shadows. Were they like me, preparing themselves for the day of judgment?
Hello.
She's dead. The police came round last night. Someone found her at the foot of a church tower, San Nicola.
Where's that?
God knows. Some village in the middle of nowhere. She threw herself from the top of the tower.
Suicide?
The police don't think so.
What?
They asked me why I thought she'd have gone all that way to kill herself. And they're right. Why the hell would she? I didn't know what to say. Why are they asking me all these questions?
Don't worry.
Don't worry. What's that supposed to mean? You must tell them what happened.
I wasn't there.
Oh, of course you were.
No. I didn't see her yesterday.
But you said you would...
I didn't see her, Gervinia.
But you promised. You said...
I wasn't there. I didn't see her.
But what if they really think I was involved?
Don't worry, I'm sure it's just routine.
I've got to be at the station this morning. More questions. Will you go with me?
Paul, I can't.
Oh, but...
I'm sorry, I'm leaving town as a client.
But you know about these things. Will you come to the funeral?
No, I'm sorry.
How long will you be away?
Well, it's just only a few days.
Little did I know I'd be away for 4 years.
I love you.
She thinks she's someone.
Dreams are so much more beautiful than the stuff they call reality.
Wearing a grey suit very tight at the waist. Some delicate white lace fluttered at her.
Do you think it's possible for the dead to live again, Michelle? I mean, can someone die and then come back and live in another person's world?
Couldn't bear to look at
you. Just keep an eye on Madeline. I'm frightened. She may come to some place.
I know.
Do it! I've got you!
4 years.
And the nightmares continue?
Yes. It's a living nightmare.
Paris is a very different city now the Germans have gone.
Yes, it's full of Americans instead, swaggering around the place like they own it.
And where have you been for the last 4 years?
North Africa.
You drink, don't you?
Too much.
To forget?
To remember. It only takes a few whiskies and I can see her. Just as she was, smiling, the afternoon sunshine round her face. Madeleine, happy with me. But she's dead. I know she is. But I can't help thinking, and I know you'll say this is crazy. I can't help thinking that she and her great-grandmother...
You believe that this young woman had already been dead once, that she used to be Pauline Joubert and was reincarnated in the body of Madeleine Gévigné.
You think I'm mad, don't you?
What is mad? Sane people believe all kinds of things.
No, but I'm not mad. I saw it with my own eyes. Madeleine used to be Pauline Joubert.
Who died 90 years ago. And now Madeleine is dead also.
Yes, but I saw it.
So for you, Madeleine may be alive again, since she has come back from the grave already once before.
Well, yes.
I'm wondering whether you really want to be cured.
I definitely do.
Then you must accept. You must accept Madeline's death. Even though you wish her to be alive still, so that you could recapture the happiness you once had, you must tell yourself she's dead, never to appear again in this life. Do you understand?
Yes. Yes, I do.
Later that day, I stood in the étoile in the pouring rain, pretending I was waiting for her. But she didn't come. I wandered through our old haunts, through the Louvre, along the river.
Excuse me. Have you got a light?
Yeah, sure.
Thanks.
I ran my finger over the inscription. To Eurydice, revived. I kept it all this time. And I wondered whether I should throw it into the river. But I didn't. I knew I never would.
Hello?
Who are you looking for?
Monsieur Gervigne.
Oh, yes. He used to live in this building, but he's dead.
He died in 1940, just before the Germans came. Were you a friend of his?
He rang to tell me of his wife's death, but I had to leave Paris, so...
Poor man. The police won't leave him alone. Convinced he's killed her, they were.
Yes, I heard they had some suspicions.
Hounded him, they did. Did they get on together? Was he here the day it happened? Had they argued? On and on. One morning he comes down, all worked up. I've had enough of this, he says. I'm clearing out, and if they want me, they can damn well come and get me. He throws a few bits and pieces in his car, and off he goes. We heard afterwards the poor man was caught by a German plane. Shot him up on the road to Le Havre.
Oh, I'm sorry. But his wife, wasn't she ill?
Madame Gervigne? No, lovely girl. Not a care in the world. We used to chat about all kinds of things. I laid her body out for the funeral. Monsieur Gervigne couldn't bring himself. So sad the way it turned out.
So sad. Oh, thank you.
I went into a cinema. It was dark and I could lose myself.
General de Gaulle's historic return to Marseille, where the grateful citizens turned out in their thousands to welcome their leader.
Uniforms, flags, the jubilant crowd being held back by the gendarmes. Close-ups of spectators with their mouths wide open, yelling silent cheers. The fat man with a pearl tie pin waving his hat. A woman turns slowly round and faces the camera. Her eyes.
Madeleine.
Sit down. What?
I sat there until the newsreel came round again and forced myself to look at it calmly and objectively. The woman on the screen was about 30, slightly heavier than Madeleine, but the resemblance was unbelievable. The man next to her was holding her arm, and they were standing outside a hotel with three big letters, one above the other, behind them. R.I.A. The Astoria?
Marseille. This is Marseille.
The town reminded me of Paris in the early spring, full of light and energy. I made my way straight to the Astoria.
Third floor, please. When was it General de Gaulle came here?
A week ago last Sunday, monsieur. Uh-huh.
And do you happen to know a middle-aged man who wears a pearl tie pin, a little on the fat side?
No, monsieur. I can't say I do.
Think again.
Sorry, monsieur. We get so many here. Third floor.
Whiskey, monsieur.
Thank you. Another.
Monsieur.
Then, in the mirror, I saw him.
See, that man behind me, the one going bald, talking to the woman in the fur coat. Do you know his name?
Al Marianne.
What's he do?
Well, bit of everything, you know.
Is that his wife?
You're kidding. He never keeps the same one long.
She turned and looked around the bar. There was no doubt. It was her. I think I'm going to die. Was I mad after all? Madeline was dead. I'd have seen the body at the foot of the church tower. The police had investigated her suicide. The concierge had laid out her corpse. No, I couldn't be. And yet...
I've been here before. I've walked through this on the arm of a man.
Excuse me, mademoiselle. Would you like to dance?
Is that all right?
Why not?
Her eyes, her lips, the cheekbones. Just as they'd been before.
What?
It's me.
Who?
Don't you recognize me? Jacques?
No. Can't say I do. Sorry.
And what's your name?
Renée Sorange.
Renée?
Her earrings were cheap, her nails painted and chipped. And the accent was coarse. From the streets. She was almost better this way.
You used to live in Paris before the war.
No, not me. I lived in Nice.
Really? Do you still paint?
I never painted.
But you've been to Rome.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Just now when I asked you to dance, you did recognise me, didn't you?
Yeah, I've never seen you before. No, look, I don't want to dance. Let me go.
It's all right. I'm a bit drunk. Is he jealous?
Marianne. I wish he was.
Black market, I suppose.
Of course. You too.
No, I'm a lawyer. You know that. Is he very busy?
Yeah. He's always out doing deals.
So I could see you sometimes when he's out. I'm in room 17 if you need me.
All right.
And you?
Room 11.
The next morning after breakfast, I waited in the lobby for Al Marianne to come down. It was like the old days, and I felt awake and refreshed, filled with purpose. When at last he left the hotel alone, I made my way up to room 11.
Who is it?
It's me, Flavier.
You've been crying.
It's nothing.
Your cheek. Did he hit you?
He had enough of me. He's throwing me out.
Oh, so why the tears? Forget about it, Marianne. I'm here now.
No, not you.
Oh, my love, at last. Come to me.
The first thing we had to do was change hotels. The Hotel de France was smaller, and the rooms were more expensive than at the Astoria, but at least there was no chance of running into Al Marianne.
What's the matter? You're like a caged animal.
I need some fresh air.
I'll be ready in a minute.
Why do you always do your hair like that?
I like it.
I hate it.
We'd only been together for a few days, and already we were arguing.
How do you like me to do it?
Well, perhaps you could do it in a sort of bun at the back of your neck.
A bun?
I like it that way.
It's so old-fashioned.
Oh, I'm sorry. Look, I'm going to wait downstairs. God. Another whiskey. Monsieur.
I stared at myself in the mirror. I looked like a dead man. I should be happy. After all, I had what I wanted, and yet, oh, what I had loved in Madeleine all along was that she wasn't quite real. Now, in my bed, she wanted to be like any other woman. If only she could admit it, admit who she really was. Then...
Jack!
Yes?
Well, here we go.
The eyes were right. But everything else about her was so wrong.
Where are we going?
I'm taking you shopping.
Oh. Look at those dresses.
You like them?
Oh, they're gorgeous. But they're so expensive, Sherry.
Be quiet. Come on.
These are the most elegant dresses we have, madame. Direct from Paris.
They're lovely, aren't they?
Do you have anything in grey?
Ah. There is this one, monsieur.
No, that's the wrong grey.
Which grey would you prefer?
I'll know it when I see it.
Certainly, monsieur.
No grey would be exactly like the one I remembered, of course. No, that's not right. Too dark.
Too dark.
Was it because I had idealised it for so long?
Monsieur?
No. Could my memory be playing tricks? There she was. Madeleine. Come to life again.
Is Monsieur satisfied?
Yes. It's perfect. She'll keep it on and we'll take the black in the same size.
Of course, Monsieur.
What do you think?
They'll do. She'll keep them on. Wrap that pair.
Oh, Jack, I don't know how to thank you.
Where's the perfumery?
I was so embarrassed. The way you shouted at that poor woman.
She should have known the perfume I was describing.
Oh, it's not her fault if they don't make it anymore. Anyway, she said you might find it in some little shop.
Well, that's no good to me. I need it now.
Why are you doing all these silly things?
Look. Just look at your reflection in the window. That woman, it is not René Soulange. It's Madeleine Givigne. Can't you see?
Oh, please. Don't start that again.
No, I want you to discover yourself. I want you to be perfect. I'm sure you'll remember if you'll just try.
But I've tried. I don't know what you want me to say.
Tell me that you're Madeleine.
But I'm not, Jack. I'm not.
We walked on in silence, the afternoon suddenly destroyed. Why couldn't I simply love this woman instead of poisoning everything like this? I seemed to delight in making her suffer. But why did she refuse to admit her secret? Back in the hotel, we lay on the bed as the light faded. The dying flowers in the vase smelt of wet earth.
Sherry, It's time we went down for dinner.
No, let's stay here for a while. I'm not hungry. In the twilight, her head on my chest, I could imagine... What's the matter? Why are you crying?
Please, don't.
But why?
It's not you. It's me. I'm sorry.
Here.
Where are you going?
Bathroom. Where's your toilet bag?
Why?
I'm looking for a handkerchief to dry your eyes.
Under the sink. Oh. It doesn't matter.
No, it matters to me. I can't bear it when you cry. Here we are. I held it up to the pale light.
Come on, Jack.
There was no mistaking it.
What are you doing, Shelley?
This was the amber necklace which belonged to Pauline Joubert. Oh, God.
Jack? What is it?
Nothing.
You drink too much. You'll kill yourself.
I know, but as you once so memorably said, it doesn't hurt to die.
Oh, here we go again.
And I can tell you the exact spot where you said it. It was by the Seine at Courbevoie, on, if my memory serves me right, and it usually does, on the 26th of April, 1940.
I don't know what's up with you tonight.
Oh, nothing, Cherie, nothing. Never felt happier. Come on, eat up, eat up.
I'm not hungry.
Really? We used to score three at a time at the Gallery Lafayette.
Please, Jacques.
Or maybe I just imagined it and I'm really going crazy.
That's it. I've had enough.
That was quite a scene you played down there.
Me?
Or do you want everyone to stare? Is that how you like it? Making the dramatic...
I can't go on like this. You're always going on about something I don't understand. I'm stuck here in this hotel.
Go back to Almarion if that's what you want.
You know that's not what I mean.
Isn't it?
Oh, you're driving me insane!
No. Please, don't cry.
Don't Cherie.
Are you scared of me?
Yes!
Well, because I'm drunk?
No!
Well, because... I'm mad?
Yes!
Why don't you wear this?
Where did you find that?
Why don't you wear it?
I don't like it. Give it to me.
You knew I'd recognize it.
Why should you recognize it? Almarion bought it for me in some junk shop in Paris.
You're lying.
Why would I lie?
Just tell me you're Madeleine Javigne.
I'm not. I'm René Soronge.
You're Madeleine. Admit it.
I'm not. Look, if you're still in love with that woman, then just get out of here and leave me alone.
But I can't. That woman is dead, or rather, she was until...
Oh, God, not again.
Look. You remember this lighter, don't you? I gave it to you at the Louvre.
I've never been to the Louvre.
Look. To Eurydice... revived. You had it with you when you died.
Oh, go away. Leave me alone.
No, here. Keep it. It's yours. And the necklace.
Yeah. I don't want them. I don't want any of this.
You're not going anywhere.
Why are you torturing me like this?
She was right. I was torturing her, but... I had to convince her. I had to coax her back to the thresholds of life. Only then would she understand what I did. That we were meant to be throughout all our lives, for eternity. Orpheus and my Eurydice.
Just let me go.
Listen, please. I've always been afraid of dying. The death of other people terrified me because it foretold my own. But after you killed yourself, all that changed. I can believe in the resurrection now. No, you're right. I'm still in love. With you. You have to stay with me. Do you understand?
I'll try.
And she did. She tried. For the next few days, things got better. We went out for walks in the sun, holding hands. We laughed. One morning, she even let me arrange her hair like Madeleine used to, pinned back in a bun. I mean, it wasn't very good. I'd never done that kind of thing before, and she only had to move her head and it all fell out. But, you know, for a moment again, she was Madeleine. And there was something strange in the way she looked at me. As if she was remembering something somewhere. Someone.
It's gone 12. How about some lunch?
I'm not hungry. You go down.
Are you sure? You all right, Cherie?
No, of course, I'm fine. I'll wait up here.
Okay.
I went down to the restaurant. She wasn't there. I ran outside just in time to see her walking up the street. Oh, she walked quickly, not looking in the shop windows. She knew where she was going. Images of Paris came flooding back. She turned down a side street, little shops full of old books and antiques. It seemed familiar, like the Rue des Saints-Pères. She crossed the road, ignoring the traffic.
And I followed just in time to see her dart into a little hotel.
Excuse me?
Yeah?
The woman who just came in, the woman in grey. What's her name?
What's it to you?
Just tell me!
Her name's Pauline Joubert.
I suppose I should have been relieved. The mystery, after all, had been solved. I wasn't mad. René was Madeleine, was Pauline.
Why are you looking at me like that?
Like what?
Like that. Funny. What have I done?
Nothing.
I'm going out. Don't you want to know where?
Where?
To Chez Maurice. The hairdressers. If that's okay with you.
You're not the prisoner.
Jacques, what's the matter? I thought we were getting on so well.
I'm fine, sorry. You run along.
Bye. And go easy on yourself. Relax.
You will come back, won't you?
Don't be silly.
Would she come back? It was true. I was the prisoner. What could I hope for? To keep her with me in that room forever? What, to stand guard over her night and day? I was held prisoner by my own fear. It was inevitable that one day she would kill herself again. Why else would she take the room in Pauline's name?
Whiskey, monsieur. Thanks. Another.
And another.
Letting the yellow liquid burn down my throat and into my stomach, burning out the image of her leaving me.
Oh, it's my fault, I know. I've driven her to it with my accusations, torturing her.
Don't you think you've had enough?
Oh, I can see now. I was so busy recreating Madeleine, I didn't see I was driving her away.
It's always the way, isn't it?
And keep the change.
The bright sun was unbearable. It dazzled my eyes and burned into my brain. I leant against the wall trying to find my balance. I found Chez Maurice just in time to see her pay. Her hair swept in a bun. The grey suit. It's Madeleine. I followed her through the bombed-out ruins of the old port. Oh, this was Marseille, but it was also Courbevoie 4 long years ago. The past was merging with the incomprehensible present. I watch as Madeleine walks up to the edge of the quay and stares out across the water. Her hand holds her skirt blowing in the wind. She looks down, studies the water, stares into nothingness. Oh, the smile. The sigh. Her feet move closer to the edge of the quay.
Madeleine, no, don't do it.
Don't let me go.
Huh?
What are you doing?
You were going to drown yourself.
No, I wasn't.
But... No, I thought...
You thought.
So, what?
I'm leaving you, Jacques. Don't you understand that? I can't take it anymore. I was going to find a boat and just go.
What about me?
What about you?
If you've decided to leave me, at least now, I have a right to know. You are Madeleine.
Oh, for the last time, no.
Then who are you?
I'm René Seron.
No, it's not true. It can't be.
It is true.
But at that hotel, you gave your name as Pauline Joubert.
Oh, so I could escape you. I knew you'd try to find me. If you thought I was really Madeleine, you'd be able to preserve her memory and forget me.
I suppose that's why you've had your hair done like her, the bun and the grey suit?
Yes! To erase René Serange completely, so you'd have nothing left but your precious Madeleine. And I could escape.
But it's you I want to keep.
It's too late.
No, but if I promised never to mention her again.
Oh, God, don't make promises you can't keep.
No, but I can. I will. Look, it's simple. Just admit to me now that you are Madeleine and I will never mention it again. We'll get away from here and we'll start all over. We deserve it.
I'm not Madeleine.
You are. Look, oh my God. Just now you had that look of hers when she stared into the water as if she were off in another world.
It's called trying to forget.
Forget what?
To forget. Oh, I can't tell you.
Tell me, please.
All right.
I am, Madeline.
Why should I believe you?
After all this, you want proof?
No. You recognised me the moment you saw me at the Astoria, didn't you?
Yes. I knew it was you straight away.
So why not tell me then? Why all this play acting?
Because I didn't want you to ever know.
I've known all along.
No, not that. Listen. Listen. Turn out the light, will you? The woman you knew in Paris. The one you saw in the theatre with your friend Gervigne. The one you followed. The one you pulled out of the river. That woman never died. Do you understand? I never died.
Of course not. You became Renée.
No, my darling, no. If only... I didn't become Renée. I always was Renée.
Huh?
That's my real name, Renée Soulange. And it's me you've been in love with all along. You never knew Madeleine Gervigne.
Huh?
I pretended to be her. I wish I could say he'd forced me to be his accomplice, but...
Accomplice? But you mean... The body at the foot of the church tower was...
Yes. That was Madeleine. Paul killed her. That's the truth.
So you were Paul's mistress? And the two of you cooked up this plan to get rid of his wife? Why?
Why else? Money. What? She had the money.
But why did Gervigne want me to keep an eye on her? On you?
To divert suspicion.
What?
You see, Madeleine had no reason to commit suicide. He needed someone to come forward who could say that she was fascinated by death. Obsessed with fantasies. You're a lawyer. Who wouldn't believe you?
The bastard. He used me.
I'm sorry.
And poor little Gilbert, I suppose all that was made up for you.
Oh. No, no. It was her story that gave Paul the idea.
Oh, my God. So when you jumped into the river... Madeleine! Oh, my God!
I'd never have drowned. I'm a strong swimmer.
But what about the church tower? How did he know we'd go there?
I drove that day, remember?
So all the details were worked out. You both wearing the same grey suit, this lighter in her handbag?
Yes. He drove out to the tower, took her up to the top, and killed her. He knew you were scared of heights and you'd never be able to follow me.
I just need some fresh air.
No, that's the wrong door, Madeleine. That leads up to the belfry.
I'd like to take a look.
You screamed. And he threw her body from the tower.
Assuming that you would go to the police and tell them she committed suicide.
But I didn't.
Then the police started asking questions about Paul's married life and... It didn't take them long to find a motive, all the money in Madeleine's name. Then these women came forward to say that they saw a couple in a black car at the church.
Gervigne's car. And I suppose you cleared out as soon as things got too hot. And Paul died on the road to Le Havre.
I've been living through a waking nightmare. The woman I'd loved had been Renée all along. Playing a part to ruin the lives of an innocent man and woman, to murder the woman and destroy the man. I looked at her. Into those beautiful pale blue eyes, flooding with tears, just like Madeleine when I pulled her from the water. No, but that was real, whatever she might say.
Please, Jack. Please forgive me.
Oh, Madeleine.
I stroked her hair. Her cheek. The tiny place at the side of her mouth. Her soft white neck.
I'm not Madeleine.
And then... Summoning all my strength, my hands tightened around her throat.
You're lying. You've never stopped lying. You don't know what the truth is anymore, but I do. I love you, Madeleine. I've always loved you.
From the moment I put my arm around you, I knew you were the only woman in my life. Don't you see, Madeleine? Those drives in the country, the flowers, the Louvre, our dreams. Madeleine, tell me you understand. Madeleine.
She wasn't moving. I took my hands from her neck.
No.
Come back, come on, move away, there's nothing to see.
So, Monsieur Flavier, you admit it, you killed her.
I did it.
Why?
Because I loved her.
Strange way of showing it. All right, you'll have to make a full confession. Take him away.
Wait. Can I kiss her?
Oh. I suppose so.
She looked so beautiful lying there. And written on her face was an immense peace at last. I'd never seen that look before.
I shall wait for you, Madeleine.
Jacques Flavier was Michael Maloney, Madeleine and René Sorange, Sarah Smart, Paul Javignier, Robert Pickavance, Dr. Ballard, Seamus O'Neill, Lariche, Chris Jack, and the old concierge, Daryl Fishwick. The Living and the Dead by Pierre Boileau and Thomas Narcejac was dramatized for radio by Adrian Bean and directed in Manchester by Pauline Harris.